Good morning. Welcome, dear students. Today we'll be looking at the topic in gynecology, that is metropathia hemorrhagica and its homeopathic management. Myself, Dr. Jyoti S. Kalantri, I'm an associate professor in obstetric department from Takatmal Srivalam Homeopathic Medical College, Amravati, welcomes you in this my presentation. So, what are the goals we will be looking for in today's presentation? This are introduction of my topic, then FIGO classification of abnormal uterine bleeding, common terminologies we'll be looking related to menstrual cycle, approach to the patient, here we will go for etiopathogenesis, then diagnosis with the base support of investigations, management options both medical and surgical, and recommendations. I would recommend our homeopathic treatment until it is in its domain. Next. Introduction. But before going for proper topic of abnormal uterine bleeding, we will be focusing more on metropathia hemorrhagica. But we should be well acquainted with the normal physiology of the menstrual cycle. What is menstrual cycle? It is the cyclic uterine bleeding which is outflowing through vagina. It is ranging duration, interval between the cycle is between 25 to 35 days, and the flow lasts between 3 to 5 or even 7 days. Plus minus 1 week is possible, it's an individual variation. And the average blood loss may be 20, 30, 60. Upper limit is 80 ml of the blood. Now we consider menorrhagia as excessive uterine bleeding more than 80 ml of the blood. But here, menses may also till the limit of 60 to 80 ml. But menorrhagia has got pathology and this is a physiological condition. Now coming to the abnormal uterine bleeding, it is defined as changes in frequency of menses, its duration of flow and amount of blood loss. Exactly, abnormal uterine bleeding, the cases, how much they are prevalent. 30% of the reproductive age women suffer from menorrhagia, and menorrhagia and uterine fibroid, which accounts for hysterectomy, are 60 to 80%. We can call it as the 75% also. So AUB surgeries are mostly attributed 25%. Okay. One national study found that menstrual disorders were the reason for 19% of 20 million visits to physician OPDs for gynecological conditions over a 2 year period. Means 5 to 10% cases per 100. So this is so much prevalent in female of from the puberty till the perimenopausal age group of women. So this is a clinical topic we will be discussing today. Short idea about the hypothalamus and pituitary ovarian axis. See, this is a hypothalamus. Hypothalamus is secreting the pulsatile GnRH, which is stimulating the anterior pituitary gland. Through the blood circulation, it stimulates the anterior pituitary gland to secrete the sex hormones. Hypothalamo-pituitary ovarian axis. Normal physiology of menstruation, how it functions. What is GnRH? This is a gonadotropin-releasing hormone, which is very steady before puberty. And after puberty, there is a pulsatile secretions of the GnRH from the hypothalamus. Hypothalamus is always under the effect of environmental anxieties, worries, anorexia, and lot of things. Now this GnRH is stimulating through the blood circulation to the pituitary anterior, which secretes the hormone, sex hormone, FSH and LH. We call it follicular stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. Now this act on the gonads in female ovary. We can see this quick review. If this FSH is secreted, this is secreted. So estrogen and progesterone is stimulated. This stimulates endometrium is now proliferated. So endometrium proliferation is under the effect of hormone estrogen in first phase, pre-ovulatory phase. This estrogen progesterone gives negative feedback to the pituitary hormone, and again hypothalamus is stimulated for GnRH. Gonads also secrete the hormone inhibin, which again gives negative feedback to the pituitary gland. So this is how we see how the HPO axis functions. Once again, the body temperature, if we talk, normally it drops at 0.5, drops at ovulation by 0.5 degree and it raises. This is BBT. Next, how is the histology of menstrual cycle? Menses, in the proliferative phase, we see under the effect of FSH, endometrium is growing. Side by side, there is follicular development. One dominant follicle is formed, which is now releasing the hormone, which is now releasing the oocyte after the rupture of ovarian follicle. This is under the effect of hormone LH. And so we can see LH is at peak at ovulation. And in follicular, basically in the pre-ovulatory phase, FSH and LH are very same in ratio. Now FSH after the post-ovulatory phase is declining towards it. Once the corpus luteum is formed after ovulation, it secretes the hormone progesterone, which is at peak in the luteal phase. We call it as a post-ovulatory or luteal phase. Now, next we'll see actual physiology of menstrual cycle. Here, endometrium normally produces the prostaglandins from the arachidonic acid. Such prostaglandins include PGE2, PGI2, PGF2-alpha, thromboxane A2. PGE2 and PGI2, these are the vasodilators, and they will diminish the platelet aggregation. Similarly, PGF2-alpha and thromboxane, they are the vasoconstrictors. They will increase the platelet aggregation. Hence, we can see that progesterone is responsible for production of PGF2. Now, initially in the proliferative phase, we can see the ratio in the pre-ovulatory phase. Endometrial proliferation under the effect of estrogen, the ratio of prostaglandin is 1:1. They are same. So vasoconstriction and vasodilatation go hand in hand. But post-ovulatory phase, progesterone causes endometrial proliferation, differentiation. Hence, we see PGF2-alpha is secreted by hormone progesterone. So in the post-ovulatory, definitely it will be more compared to PGE2. So the ratio is 2:1. Now we can say as long as progesterone is secreted by corpus luteum, is provided by, in this phase is maintained. Once corpus luteum ceases the function, endometrium outflows the blood circulation, there is withdrawal of estrogen progesterone, and this necrosis and this everything endometrium is loss of in the form of menses, that is a menstrual cycle. Normal menstrual cycle, once again we will see, they start at the menarche, 10 to 12 years, then it establish there until menopause, it is lasting till 45 to 55 years. It is regulated by HPO axis, secreted by pulsatile and cyclic pattern. It is again influenced by endometrial response due to the estrogen progesterone hormones and coagulation cascade. Now, cycle length we have already discussed. Terminology is related to clinical presentations. Abnormal uterine bleeding can be presented by any of this. It may be menorrhagia, that is regular cyclic with prolonged or heavy flow. It may be polymenorrhea, frequent cycles but normal bleeding. It may be polymenorrhagia, this is frequent cycle with excessive bleeding, means long lasting. Menorrhagia, it is more than 80 ml. It is not written here, but excessive bleeding either in duration or in quantity. Metrorrhagia, it is intermenstrual bleeding, that is bleeding between periods. Oligomenorrhea, that is the infrequent cycle with normal bleeding. We can say cycle is having a duration of 35 or 40 days, but bleeding is okay. But hypomenorrhea means the girl or a woman gets a regular cycle but very scanty amount of bleeding. Say many of the time we get it cases in our OPD telling us about a bleeding for only one day or some few hours, that we can call it as a hypomenorrhea. Now looking towards the FIGO classification of abnormal uterine bleeding. this they have come up with in this recent 2011 or 12, I think, this PICO classification for the clinical differentiation of the disease. Earlier, AUB was called as DUB. Now, the new nomenclature is there. So, PALM, P-A-L-M, see the PALM. PALM and C-O-E-I-N, that is COIN. So, PALM, COIN, classification. Here, P stands for polyp, A for adenomyosis, L for leiomyoma. Leiomyoma we call nowadays as a fibromyoma, and malignancy in hyperplasia. So these disorders can be diagnosed by visual structural changes after the biopsy and histopathological studies. So these are differentiated separately, and which we cannot need of as such structural changes, which can be diagnosed by only hormonal and blood investigations. These are under the heading C for coagulopathy, means coagulation disorders, say von Willebrand's disease, thrombocytopenic purpureas and all. Ovulatory dysfunctions, ovulation disorders, and ovulatory disorders, these are the related. We will be looking for this topic mainly. Endometrial disorders, functional hyperplasias and all will come in this. Atrogenic, from outward some causes, suppose anybody is on medication, hormonal therapies, hormone replacement therapies, and not yet classified are the few classifications. We should always remember these possibilities when a patient visits to us for its treatment. Now, the classification of bleeding pattern. Two types of bleeding pattern are very common: anovulatory. Anovulatory is very much prevalent, 80%, and ovulatory is less, 20%. What is covered in anovulatory DUB? Puberty, menorrhagia, metropathia, hemorrhagica, premenopausal DUB. Puberty, menorrhagia, again endocrinal dysfunctions or basic some few pathologies are encountered here. Metropathia we will be looking in detail. Premenopausal can also covered by metropathia or other pathologies. Why ovulatory DUB is occurring? It is due to irregular ripening, irregular shedding, IUCD insertion following some sterilization operation. Irregular ripening, irregular shedding occurs because of irregular development of endometrium because of shortening of the hormone progesterone. Ovulation means once ovulation has occurred, now corpus luteum is short at its function. IUCD, due to the contraceptive effects of copper ions, there is foreign body reactions. Most of the time there is irregular spotting between the periods. Coming to our main topic, that is metropathia hemorrhagic. This is anovulatory abnormal uterine bleeding. We can say anovulatory menstrual dysfunction. Here, mainly we can say there is a painless bleeding preceded by period of amenorrhea. It is a specialized form of anovulatory AUB seen in women between 40 to 45 years of age. Here, symptoms are continuous painless vaginal bleeding. Occasionally, it is preceded by painless profuse vaginal bleeding. It is preceded by amenorrhea of 2, 3, even 6 to 8 weeks. Many people, patient come to us with amenorrhea preceded followed by menorrhagia. Sometimes they may come with menarche, adolescence period, just after 2 years of menarche, there is menorrhagia. Sometimes we get excessive menorrhagia before these precedings and before these symptoms. Then she may also come with the symptoms of anemia, that is shortness of breath, weakness, vertigo. These are the symptoms if bleeding is more. Sign-wise, we can say uniform enlargement of the uterus. Here we will go in detail now. Here, what is the pathology? A mild degree of myohyperplasia with uterine wall measuring up to 25 mm thickness and uterus is uniformly enlarged because of hypertrophy of the myometrium. Here again, endometrium shows the thickness. It becomes thick, vascular, polypoidal. There is abundant stroma, connective tissue, but we'll find glands are enlarged, spiral tortuosity of the vessels. There is variety of change, varying degrees of endometrial glands. They become dilated, some are small, some are long. So such is the disparity of the cellular pattern, glandular pattern, as well as stroma in the endometrium. So when we see a microscopic picture, we get a different appearance here. There is hyperplasia of all the elements of the endometrium. We will look forward in this slide of endometrial hyperplasia, and the glands increase in number but may vary in size and shape. Some of them become dilated, cystic. We called it as a cystic glandular hyperplasia. The cystic glandular hyperplasia is also named as Swiss cheese pattern. This is what we will get in an endometrial histopathological study of these women around the perimenopausal age group. Now this interstitial tissue become abundant, vascular and compact. This is what the microscopic view, where there will be no secretory change in the endometrium. Areas of necrosis can be seen like we see in a menstrual cycle. Now what are the changes in the ovary? Ovary may be bilateral or unilaterally enlarged. Why it is enlarging? Due to unruptured cystic follicle. Maybe unilateral, bilateral enlargement, but there is definitely absence of active corpus luteum. Why? Because there is no ovulation has occurred as LH is deficient. So in short, what is metropathia hemorrhagica? Because of no surge of LH, there is anovulation, and this chronic anovulation is there. But cystic follicles are giving rise to continuous estrogen. So this is unopposed estrogen. Now this unopposed estrogen acts on the uterus and causing its proliferation. So this disparity is seen in the Swiss cheese pattern. We call it as a cystic glandular hyperplasia. Coming to the ovulatory DUB, in short, we should know how it is more common in reproductive age group. Metropathia, we see it is common in perimenopausal age group as well as sometime it is seen in adolescent girl. But ovulatory is very common in reproductive age group, means maturity group. Patients usually present with cyclic excessive bleeding, even premenstrual sweating. Sometimes it is associated with pain. Coming to anovulatory DUB physiology. In some adolescent girls and perimenopausal women, ovarian follicles develop follicular stimulating hormone and produce estrogen. It is in the variable amount and leading to proliferation of endometrium. We have already seen in physiology of menses, the proliferation is due to unopposed estrogen. Here the dominant follicle may not develop the insufficient LH surge, no ovulation, no development of corpus luteum and no progesterone, which I have already discussed. And hence, in this metropathia hemorrhagica, you will not find secretory changes in endometrium. Estrogen still is secreted by follicles, that is granulosa cells. Unopposed estrogenic stimulation and sometime hyper threshold, we can say, hyper level of estrogen resulting in overgrowth of endometrium, we call it hyperplasia. So it results into prolonged cycle and hence increased blood loss is there. Now what exactly again happens when endometrium overgrows its blood supply? Lack of progesterone causes decreased PGE to vasodilators initially, and ovascular necrosis of the functional endometrium occur. Endometrium is shed off. Lack of vasoconstrictors are there. We call it PGF2-alpha. And thromboxane results in excessive blood loss, which is painless and prolonged. So this is the main symptom we find in metropathia. There is painless, prolonged bleeding because PGF2-alpha and thromboxane result in excessive blood loss, and irregular ripening of shedding continues for such a long time. That's why there is irregular, prolonged bleeding. Persistent follicles undergo the formation of cysts. Because there is no ovulation, so follicles become cystic. Once again, a flow chart for how we will get the microscopic appearance. What exactly happens? Ovulatory DUB. Patient has variable period of amenorrhea followed by prolonged, heavy, painless bleeding. Prolonged unopposed estrogen causes proliferative endometrium. This may lead to development of normal endometrial hyperplasia. It is a simple hyperplasia. It may change into complex hyperplasia. It may change into complex hyperplasia with ERTPIA, and few may get adenocarcinoma. Now we will see the slides one by one. See, this is a Swiss cheese pattern appearance of the endometrium. The variability of the endometrial glands, they are variably enlarged. This becomes cystic and thick abundant stroma. This is called as cystic glandular hyperplasia. Now, we will focus on primary endometrial hyperplasia, simple hyperplasia. Simple endometrial hyperplasia, this is 1-to-1 ratio of the glands and endometrium. We can see glands are there enlarged and thick stroma, connective tissue, vascularity is there properly. This is same in ratio, 1-to-1 gland as well as stroma. Complex hyperplasia, see glands are more. Enlargement of the glands and more glands and less stroma. This is complex. Here the ratio of gland and stroma is 2:1. We will discuss this again. Now after that, atypical. This is atypical hyperchromatic, means more colored large nucleus. Cytoplasm nucleus ratio is changed. Variable size of nucleus we can say, and very much hyperchromatic filled. This is atypical cell. Now this is not good if you find this in endometrial study. Simple, complex, atypia cells. And one is finally atypical. Now coming to the why bleeding is heavy in cystic glandular hyperplasia. You may have question, I think. Again, I'm telling for you. It's a prolonged estrogen stimulation. Then proliferation of glandular epithelium of the endometrium leading to threshold bleeding. What is threshold bleeding? Menopausal women have got decreased number and quality of the follicles in the ovary. Now this decreased numbers of follicles are giving low amount of estrogens because of deficient FSH. At the perimenopausal age group, it is very common. Estrogen is scanty, so it is causing some areas enlarged and some are not. Hence, the threshold bleeding occurs in the menopausal age group women because of prolonged estrogen stimulation. No progesterone. Now, as there is chronic anovulation, LHCL, that is corpus luteum, is not formed or inadequate, it will not secrete progesterone. So, progesterone is deficient in the luteal phase. Corpus luteum also releases the relaxin hormone. Now bleeding, why it occurs? Bleeding is due to hemorrhagic necrosis and it is not by the dissolution of reticulum fibers. We see in menstrual physiology, normal menstrual cycle also. Endometrium has got two layers, superficial functional layer and basal layer. At every menstrual period, superficial functional layer have got glands and this stroma, it is shed off. And then once the menstrual bleeding occurs, then basal cells again regenerates the normal germinal functional layer. So the regeneration process is continuous. Here, the abnormal vascular bed and hyperplastic glandular tissue is formed because of unopposed estrogen, as we are lacking in progesterone. So much enlarged endometrium is there. That's why spiral artery, the tortuosity of the vessels is also there. This tortuosity gives rise to cystic hyperplasia. With this ovary, because of continuous secretion of estrogen, follicles may become cystic, and we know they are secreting continuous estrogen because there is no counteraction by hormone progesterone. It is not counteracting as it is not present. Estrogen stimulates fibrinolytic activity. Estrogen stimulates proteolytic enzymes and no coagulation forms. So there is platelet disaggregation and shedding takes place. So this is why there is excessive bleeding in CGH. Threshold bleeding, this is often seen in perimenopausal women. Again, I am discussing this is insufficient development of ovarian follicles resulting in low estrogen level and it does not sustain the endometrium or trigger the LH surge. Because there is low estrogen, it will not sustain endometrium, hence it will get bleed. And LH is also not triggered for ovulation. This is how there is threshold bleeding. How such women can have prolonged excessive bleeding due to absence of progesterone and lack of PGF2-alpha. I have already told you PGF2-alpha is a vasoconstrictor which is secreted, which is formed by the hormone progesterone. Bleeding PV in these women can be controlled by cyclical estrogen plus progesterone combination therapy, as both are at low level. This is what gynecologists are doing. They are providing synthetic preparations of hormones for normal cycles. Now, endometrium and hyperplasia, cystic hyperplasia, simple atypia called Schwischke's hyperplastic gland stroma, cystic glands, thick wall tortuous dilated, thick wall tortuous dilated spiral arteries and veins, infarction and thrombosis of the blood vessels, hence necrosis of the functional endometrium, and then it is slough off. Now, coming to the, we have discussed one thing I want to mention. Even simple hypertrophy, simple endometrial hyperplasia has got 1% risk of changing into adenocarcinoma in the absence of atypical cells. If atypical cells are found in this also, simple endometrial hyperplasia, then the risk of getting adenocarcinoma, endometrial cancer, increases to 10%. So we should not take very lightly if a woman is giving simple endometrial hyperplasia. Similarly, complex hyperplasia, the risk of developing endometrial cancer is 5%. But if here also if we get multiple atypia, atypical nucleus, then risk is increased to 30%. So endometrial hyperplasia should always be obtained in the perimenopausal age group of women to know the abnormal uterine, various classified causes, or whether it is simple metropathia hemorrhagica, which requires a hormonal supportive treatment. Now, incidence of malignancy, this I have already discussed. Simple will have a 1%, 30%. It is further increased in perimenopausal women are obese. Obese women have got a very amount, the most amount of adipose tissue, which may change androgens, that is androgens, into estrogens. That's why there is more estrogen in obese women. That's why we ask obese women to reduce the weight for having a normal menstrual cycle. This is seen in those who are diabetic also, defective functioning, and estrogen therapies. Most of the perimenopausal women wants estrogen. This is estrogen therapy, synthetic estrogen, definitely it will have its effects. Similarly, it is increased due to hypertension, relative infertility, history of cancer, endometrium in family, and had PCOD. Why PCOD women have got this increased bleeding, heavy bleeding? Because same thing again, anovulation. Anovulation is a chronic in polycystic ovarian disease. No ovulation means no corpus luteum, but unopposed estrogen is acting over the endometrium. Hence, PCOD girls, seen in young adults and girls, they have a excessive bleeding. So this same pathology what we see in the metropathia hemorrhagica. Of course, past and family history, medical history becomes important to rule out this disease. So we can say this metropathia hemorrhagica or abnormal uterine bleeding is actually a disease of exclusion. We have to exclude other pathologies, so then we can come to the diagnosis of this disease. Investigations proper. Now, coming to investigations, thorough medical history is important related to past history, surgical history, medical history, family history, history of AUB in family members, then thorough history. And treatment is also based on what, if a woman, what is the age of a female? She's a puberal, adolescent, or perimenopausal. If she is a reproductive age group woman, we should always find out if she want a fertility function to be retained. Then amount of bleeding is also important for further diagnosis, investigation, and treatment. So this is how we will investigate. The thorough examination, medical examination, and investigations are required. Laboratory testing for hemoglobin, TLC, DLC, bleeding time, clotting time, prothrombin time. So this is to exclude the hematological disorders in abnormal uterine bleeding. And hemoglobin, if she's anemic, excessive bleeding, it will be deficient. If any infection associated or any other PIDs, this DLC, TLC will be raised. ESR is a non-specific modality. It is raised in most of the infection. Only in the perimenopausal age group, we should search for blood sugar. Then thyroid functioning in adolescent, also in maturity, to know the all these things we are doing, looking for any hormonal disorder or presence of anemia, leukemia, diabetes, and thyroid disorders. Get this examination done, we get the report, and most important investigation is sonography. So in this ultrasonography, exclude all the pelvic lesions, say fibroids, endometrial thickening, endometriosis, PCOD, polyps, IUCD pregnancy means associated with IUCD. So these all things can be picked up by sonography. So we advise transvaginal sonography in maturity age group or transabdominal in puberty or adolescence age group. This will guide you proper the site of lesion, the progress and everything. Then hysteroscopy and hysteriography. Hysteriography, if hysteroscopy is not available, hysteriography. This we can say hysterosalpingography, we also do it in infertility cases. Any lesions, fibroid, polyp, and means the filling defect of the uterine cavity and fallopian tube. Suppose any tuberculosis is existing, then it may damage completely tube and uterus. So everything can be visualized by hysterosalpingography for patency and for any pathology. Most important modality is dilatation and curettage. Here the endometrial samplings for histopathological report is done. The type of endometrium which we have discussed, whether it is a secretory in ovulatory or no secretory in anovulatory. Again, proliferative or adenomatous, any inflammations, tuberculosis or cancerous lesion, all these things can be covered in dilatation. So endometrial tissue is then evolved and it is sent to histopathology where we have discussed we can get any type of endometrial hyperplasia or cystic one. So it is diagnostic and few people patient. It is also therapeutic. Coming to hysteroscopy, this can diagnose almost all the pathology and site, even fibroids, polyps, any abnormality. Now, all the time, we should also exclude any pregnancy, any history of, we should always look for abortion and ectopic pregnancy because the presentation of metropathia hemorrhagica is like period of amenorrhea followed by continuous bleeding. This is seen in both abortion and ectopic pregnancy. So USG will also rule out that whether there is a sac, development of embryo, normal or abnormal. So we come to know bleeding is due to what? Obstetric reason or gynec reason. Now coming to the abnormal uterine bleeding, its clinical evaluation. We have to define the risk. If a woman, after all investigation, we know if she is at risk of hyperplasia, carcinoma, then if she is having no risk, then what to do? She can be provided with the hormonal therapy. If she is at the risk, then further USG, curettage and histopathological studies. If we get simple hyperplasia, again, hormonal therapy is suffice for the, it is very cheap and at low cost and easy to take, but it has also got its own side effects. Or typical hyperplasia, now this is advisable because she is more prone for malignancy. So hysterectomy is advised in the perimenopausal age group of women who have finished her family. The surgical treatment advised in this condition is conservative. These are dilatation and curettage, which may be routine or fractional. Then there may be endometrial ablation. This therapy is there. It is useful to remove only endometrium and uterus is conserved. So endometrial ablation can be done by laser, by roller ball, by microwave. So this is a useful modality if anybody wants to retain her uterus. Conservative treatment, patient risk. When this is advisable, surgical treatment, when medical treatment is not responding, not giving relief to her bleeding, then surgical. Surgical may first will think for conservative, then radical. But before, in between these two, a Mirena IUD is now intrauterine system, hormonal releasing Mirena is now used by many of the doctors. It reduces the, it is progesterone secreting, it reduces the bleeding, it atrophies the endometrium. Myrinine is not mentioned here, and it also relieves the pain in of abnormal continence. So myrinine is used nowadays, but if she is not responding to that also, it has got nausea, vomiting side effects. If women has completed her age, then hysterectomy total can be indicated. Total hysterectomy means removal of uterus and cervix, and subtotal means removal of only uterus. Hysterectomy indications, once again, endometrial hyperplasia with atypical cells, that is nuclei. Failed medical therapy in women over the age of 40 to 45, failed endometrial ablation, other pelvic pathology that needs surgery. Coming to the key points of metropathysia as well as AUP. AUP can be due to organic diseases or functional disorders. But again, I am repeating, metropathia is purely endocrinal menstrual dysfunction. It can occur in any age group, adolescent, reproductive, or perimenopausal. But metropathia is diagnosed by exclusion of organic lesion. Don't get confused with the terminology DUB, AUB. DUB was earlier terminology, now we call it as a AUB. Okay, drugs are hormonal given. This is intrauterine system, largestrol, this is a progesterone, this has revealed the medical treatment. If medical management fails, then we have already discussed endometrial ablation and hysterectomy can be done in premenopausal age of women. Of course, it is the individual history taking, response to treatment, and individual will to undergo the surgery and threshold of her woman to bear the complaints of bleeding, pain, everything. Now, coming to the very important part of our homeopathic management. We get such type of patients in our day-to-day practice. Every day we get these cases of metropathia, hemorrhagica. We should understand what is the miasmatic background behind it. To any case in gynecology or obstetric or any other, I would like to recommend you always go for the proper case taking. It should be artistic, scientific. As you know, homeopathic approach is holistic. So every symptom and sign is very important for the treatment. It should be taken in account. And according to the, now coming to the understanding of AUB, how can we can understand? See, aphorism and footnote 205, you can see after this lecture, homeopathic physician never treats one of the primary symptoms of chronic miasm by local remedies. Okay, for temporary time being, we'll give medicine, but this is not the complete cure. Even if the dynamic remedy succeed in freeing the basic malady, it is not diminished. So, for us, nosological diagnosis should not be bothered. Of course, we should diagnose the case, we should know the prognosis, but our medication treatment is not dependent only on the nosological diagnosis. It would be exclusively on individualization and totality. So here the basic thing is what? Cause of the cause. Why metropathia, hormonal imbalances? Here the complete imbalance in the hormone is taking place. Why it is imbalanced? That cause we have to search. That why cause of the cause is to be searched. I have already told you in the very beginning of my presentation that hypothalamus is always affected by environmental worries, anxieties, and stress. Any sorrow, any good news, bad news will affect and it will disturb the HPO axis. So we will consider miasmatic consideration here. Sora, of course it is there because it's a mother of all diseases. Here we will find hyperfunction in the form of deficient luteinizing hormone. Psychosis is also predominant because hyperplasia is there of endometrium. So predominant psychosis according to as I see. Sora is basic, so diagnostic miasm will be soropsychotic in that. So many of the gynecological condition, pelvic organs disorders comes under the miasm psychosis. If cellular RTPA and cancerous changes occurs, then it become also syphilitic. So it become a complex miasm. So psychosis is frequently affecting and antipsychotic treatment is essential. Early diagnosis and anti-miasmatic treatment only help to prevent recurrences but also prevent long-term complications. Medicine selection depends upon the individuality, so we should consider every single symptom and sign. Now the treatment options, there is a lot of scope in our homeopathy. We should have faith in our science. Hemorrhagic group of remedies are to be emerged, because basically when patient is coming to us, she will give you the history of painless excessive bleeding. What is basic idea? We should allay her anxiety, allay her trouble of getting anemic and having excessive bleeding. So whatever symptom totality matches to any of the hemorrhagic group, which are not mentioned here also, we should prescribe that first. And of course, there is a role of constitutional remedy if she fits in any of these drugs like Stuja, Sepia, Pulsatilla to remove the miasmatic blockage, and constitutional treatment will only help. Now we will see, depending upon the bleeding characteristics, how we can give these remedies. If we talk about Belladonna, many of the drugs you know, your students, you all know Belladonna is having a hemorrhagic diathesis and bleeding is hot. The other menses are early, profuse, offensive and hot. This is important. You will find patient will always complain of pulsations and throbbings of carotid. We can observe. So pulsations all over the body because circulatory disturbances are found in Belladonna. Nervous system is also equally affected. The congestion and perverted senses are there. She may become violent, anytime anxious, fearful, so restlessness is marked. And this all will have a sudden onset. If we get such type of picture, we can follow with Belladonna. Can give from lower to 30 to 100, or you can repeat this medicine as it has got very less days of low days. Frequently you can repeat because it has not got very long lasting action, and even you can increase the potency if it is relieving. Next is Sabina. There is a special action of Sabina on uterus, serous and fibrous membrane. Sabina is also a remedy having a psychotic 10th, we can see there is a longer joint pain due to rheumatoid arthritis and gout. So acting on the uterus, there is again endometrial proliferation leading to hemorrhages. Here mixed fluid or clotted bleeding is found in Sabina, aggravated on motion. Pain is very typical extending from sacrum to pubis due to a tonicity condition of uterus is also found. Now, metropathia patient will not give you the symptom of pain, but any of the AUB patient comes to you, if this is the presentation, in my clinical experience also, I have found this is very much, this drug is giving very much positive results if it is suited. But you should always get any tendency of recurrent abortion or a past abortion. Always do head to foot examination for the warts, joints, all these troubles. Next is Next is EpiCac. EpiCac has got hemorrhage, which is bright red fluid. It is profuse, soaks the blood. We call it, in the drug proving also, our masters have written that it makes the pool on the blood. Pool on the blood, nobody tells you, but it is a profuse, bright red fluid, bleeding, gushing in menses, associated with constant nausea and vomiting. So constant nausea and vomiting is there, which is even not relieved by vomiting. Patient will tell you about pain, which is extending from navel to uterus. Clean tongue and tylism is a common symptom of EpiCac. This is also suited to women who are chilly and suffers from dyspnea. Melifolium, Trillium and Thalassemia are useful drugs in clinical practice. If you get the cases of bright red painless bleeding without any fever, without any pain, menses are early, profuse, protracted, bad effects of fall and also cause continuous bleeding. So melifolium can be given in from mother tincture as well as in lower triturations. It is a very good remedy which follows after aconite and arnica in bleeding conditions. Similarly, Trillium pendulum, there are uterine hemorrhages with very much faintness and dizziness leading to paleness and anemic conditions. There is history of patient gives you as if her back are falling into pieces. So she will always bind her back tightly. in order to get the relief. And always give the gushing of blood on slightest provocation, movement, there is profuse loss of bleeding. In trium also, after abortion, we can give this. This is important for metrology and climatic period. So can be employed here. Collapsi bursa pestis, this remedy have uric acid diathesis. If you get this and patient comes to with the frequent copious menses, every alternate period is profuse, every alternate period may be painful, and dark offensive stains are indelibly difficult to wash off. This remedy is found to be antioxidant. This is a recent new study, can be given in any age group, but more so suitably perimenopausal age group. If she is having her kidney disorders, bloodstain, urine, cystitis or calculus or very other pathologies in the kidney, so can be given very nicely in this women who have a kidney disorders associated with metropathia hemorrhagica. And last, finally, after leaving, after patient, once the patient is relieved of bleeding, she is having normal menstrual cycle, then you can think for any of the constitutional remedy. You know the totality of pulsatilla, calcary and all, and you can treat her accordingly. Doses can be given according to the susceptibility of the patient. But recent studies of these particular drugs, that they can be given in the Sabana and all. Similarly, Crotalus or Crocus sativa, China and Ferrum Fos, these are also very important. Calcarea Fos and Ferrum Fos can be given as a biochemic group of remedy to relieve the anemia and debility. So here I end. Any queries?